Benvenuti a tutti. Welcome to Italian America, Long Island. My name is Dave Anthony Setteducati. Tonight we have a very special guest, Mr. Lou Gallo. Lou is involved in the Order Sons of Italy in America. He's been a high school teacher, and he's been involved in politics in the town of Brookhaven. Lou, welcome to the show.
Oh, great to be here, Dave. Anytime.
So, Lou, what inspired you to get involved with the Order Sons of Italy in America?
Well, I tell you, when I was young, I always had great pride in my Italian-American background. In fact, I was a kid, I used to boast about it a lot. I thought we were fairly special then, of course, with all of the hullabaloo in my house, when the aunts and the uncles came over. It was a great time, full of ebullience and enthusiasm. And as I grew older and had a chance to take part in the order, I took the chance. And when I took the chance, I kind of moved up the ladder fairly quickly because I was connected with people. We had one great connection, and that was that ethnicity, and that's what I loved about it. We all had the similar backgrounds, we had the similar experiences, and you really create the cohesion as a result. And because of that, I kind of moved rather quickly up the line. I was a vice president, I was the president of the lodge, I became the district chairman, I was the district one state trustee, the district a chair of all the presidents, and then of course state trustee, and then I eventually became the chairman of the New York State Commission for Social Justice, the anti-defamation arm of the order.
Tell us a little bit about the mission of the CSJ, Bill.
It's really twofold. One is the principal function is to fight bias and bigotry against Italians and Italian Americans. We do it by targeting that particular circumstance or individual directly, either through emails, personal contact, letters, whatever it's necessary to raise the consciousness of the target that they have done something wrong and that we want some kind of corrective action. In tandem with that, we have the second mission, which is to create a positive image of Italians and Italian people through education and public relations. We have a very, very expansive library, you might say, in our storage facility where we publish all kinds of positive image material, pamphlets, bookmarks, and posters in tremendous voluminous amounts, and we disseminate those out to lodges and clubs and schools. And we try to present that image and pass out this particular information so that people really see we're better than the mafia, we're better than the stereotypes you see on TV. They get 98% of the attention when the positive stuff only gets about 2%, and we're trying to change that paradigm.
Absolutely. Now, I know historically, the Sons of Italy helped immigrants, and in the years around the turn of the century, the bias against Italians was very, very strong. And thanks to the CSJ and the Sons of Italy and others who worked, we have a much more positive image of Italians now. So what are some of your current projects with the CSJ?
Well, we have two big ones that are going on right now, and that is, first, Save Columbus Day. The indigenous peoples of this country have a different view of what Columbus is really all about. They take a very negative tone. We think it's a little too abusive because they actually make charges about a man that basically, not a prince or a saint, but some of the things that they accuse him of, making him responsible for all of the abuses and ills of European colonization, and we don't think it's fair. We try to set the record straight by taking a look at the positive side. And the positive side is, obviously, that this man did truly make a discovery. And it was a discovery for Europeans in the 15th century, which ushered in, of course, further settlement, further colonization, a mass migration of people from all over Europe that brought their ideals and their folkways and their culture, eventually settled the Western Hemisphere and developed it, created a lot of prosperity, which in turn created the greatest country on the face of the earth. So we go around trying to dispel these notions. We actually have a t-shirt we peddle around, Save Columbus Day. All right, and of course the next major project we have is we're very, very vigilant in the media, print and broadcast about mafia stereotypes. We are very, very concerned about that. And we offset it. We don't have the money or the attorneys you know, to fight them tooth and nail. So we, again, we resort to our positive image status. I do a project called History in a Box. I've done 40 presentations, and it's basically pulling artifacts out of a box. And when I make the presentation before clubs and community groups or schools, I try to show them that we're not Poli Walnuts, we're not Vito Corleone. This is who we are. We're Marconi, we're Da Vinci, we're Caboto, we're Pirandello, Fermi, Fauci, you know, Machiavelli. These are the people who were Italians. This is the legacy that we have left behind. This is the kind of thing that has developed Western civilization upon which many societies treasure. So we're trying to do that job. It's a very tough job because a lot of stuff happens spontaneously, and you have to react, and you have to create priorities. It's almost like working triage. You have to say, well, I got this going and that going, but guess what? I got to get to this type of thing, you know. So another thing we're working on is Our Lady of Loretto Church. We're really trying to preserve that church in Brooklyn. It was built by Italian physical labor at the turn of the 20th century. And, well, the owner happens to be the Diocese of New York, Diocese of Brooklyn, I'm sorry, and they're trying to demo it. And we're working with community groups and working with CSJ. We're trying to do our best to actually save that church. We're trying to get the council person involved. If we get the council person involved, we can get the church landmarked and preserved, and then we'd be entitled to restoration money. So that's our thrust, those two things, basically.
Why do you think that at this particular moment in time, there is such a movement to replace Columbus Day? Do you have any?
Yeah, because, it really is a change of thinking that's going on in this country. It's really part of a bigger picture. The way I see it, much of our cultural institutions are under attack. Capitalism, our system of government, the people we elect, the things that we do in schools, with the Common Core coming out. And I think this is all part of this. Some of it is radicalism. Some of it are people who are challenging our cherished institutions and think there's a better way. Bernie Sanders' candidacy, I would say, is indicative of the fact there are critiques against capitalism. And I think the indigenous peoples in the country feel that some of the things that we cherish as part of our European heritage should be challenged and should be, as far as I'm concerned, ended. And so they feel that Columbus Day should not be a day respective of what we believe in, but it should be a day to honor the indigenous peoples. Our position in CSJ? Sure, have your day. You have a right, just like everybody else. But we see Columbus Day, and it is an American holiday, not necessarily an Italian holiday, but Italians have appropriated it because, well, Columbus was the son of Italy. And we're the ones who are out in the forefront defending the holiday as much as we possibly can. And we hope that, we can convince people to hold off on this kind of thing, even though in certain cases we were successful. In Colorado, we turned back the tide there. Oklahoma City turned back the tide, but other places have adopted Indigenous Peoples Day, either coexisting with Columbus Day or wiped it out completely and substituted Indigenous Peoples Day. So that's really what it is. I think the country's at the throes. We're at a cultural war. I really believe this. And we're at a watershed right now. And we could go and still maintain tradition and our heritages, or we take on a new path. And again, it's a blind path. We don't know where that's going to lead.
So the alternative is not to eliminate Columbus Day, but to offer them another day, perhaps in another month.
Exactly.
And the one that they probably do deserve.
Well, I must say that I have suggested it. Our big battle is with Southampton School District right now, which is entertaining, the only school district on the island entertaining that change in the day. And we feel that if we, if we don't stake our claim there, it's going to spread, and it's going to really be injurious to our heritage and America's heritage, too, as well. So we think that what we should do is to mount a strong offense as much as possible. I've reached out to the Southampton schools to make a presentation on Columbus. I just written a piece in the Southampton Press, which is a counterpoint to a gentleman that's in favor of Indigenous Peoples Day. I'm waiting for the editor to say whether I will be in the viewpoint section or push the letters to the editor. So we mount a very strong offense, and we're out there defending America's heritage, Italian heritage, as much as we can, because this country, after all, the Columbus Day has been around since 1937 as a federal holiday, and it's been celebrated as a celebration since 1792. when Tammany Hall actually launched the first Columbus Festival and celebration in New York City. Now all of a sudden it's not good enough?
Fascinating. You know. Now, Lou, you're involved in several other projects with the CSJ, such as the Taste of Italy project that's coming up and the Italian Cultural and Heritage Fair. Could you tell us a little bit about each of those?
Yeah, sure. Well, the Taste of Italy is really good. As you know, you're playing a part. We have invited David because to provide some of the musical accompaniment. And the whole idea is the same thing that we always try to propose as far as positive image. And that is, hey, take a look at what Italy has. We got the food. We have exhibits on Commedia d'Arte. We're going to have the Medal of Honor exhibits exhibit, which shows that there are 29 Italian Americans that have won, that have received the Medal of Honor. I've just contacted an artist to show her wares about some of the work she's done that demonstrate Italian culture. I'm going to be this year dressed as Christopher Columbus myself as the MC, and we're going to show also this year some of the regional customs of Italy. So when you see this cultural explosion, and that's what it is, people will see, hopefully, that they will appreciate our culture, and that it's been around, and we're going to exhibit our pride as much as we possibly can. The festival in Smithtown we did, that was also the same kind of thing. But I'll tell you, it's not a feast. People think it's a feast. It's not a feast. We do more than the feasts. We've invited writers to sell books there. We've invited people to sing, as you well know. You took part in that.
Yes.
We've had an Italian car there. We've had all kinds of presentations on winemaking and people reciting poetry. We even had Tom Van Dyce from the president of Solera Lodge do a presentation on the Picciarilli brothers, who are master architects and master builders. So we, again, offer a wide assortment. And we try to tell people, you know, this is way beyond the mafia stuff and stereotypes. This is who we really are and have been for a very, very long time. And the more we get that message out, we think we will offset some of this defamatory stereotyping that's going on in the print and broadcast media. So that's our intent, and that's why we do it.
Wonderful. Wonderful. I know in my own experience, being a musician, for many years I played at catering halls. And I remember speaking to an agent, and I wanted to get signed up at this agency. And he said, well, what's your background? I said, well, I played at such and such a catering hall and such and such a catering hall. Now, they were Italian-American caterers, because I'm an Italian-American person. That's my culture. So his first word out of his mouth, oh, so you're one of those connected Italians, are you?
Exactly.
So they immediately assumed that I was somehow involved with the mafia. And that shocked me, just shocked me so much.
You know, a long time ago, the National CSJ did a study. Two very interesting elements came out of that study. Three, I'll tell you what the third one was. I thought it was very interesting. I don't even consider the third one a stereotype. The first one was 75% of the people in this country think we are connected somehow. I was stunned by that figure because I could figure 10%, 20%, but 75% of the people in this country think that. The second thing that came out was most people think, you know, Italians are solid blue-collar workers. And although we have a segment of Italians that are that, but 66% of Italian Americans are in the professions. And the third one I don't even consider a stereotype. But most Americans think, oh, women are beautiful. And I don't think that's a stereotype. I think that's a truism.
I have to agree with that. I do have to agree with that.
They said they're beautiful. Oh, absolutely. There's no question there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, Lou, what direction do you see the Osaya taking in the future?
Well, I think we have some very severe challenges, and hopefully the future presidents really wrestle with this. Let's face it, we're not getting any younger. Most of the people in the organization are either middle-aged or older. We do have some very prominent young people who are making a great contribution, but we need much more of them. Because in 10 or 20 years, if we don't wrestle with this, we're going to pass into oblivion. I really believe that. So we have to, and I don't say the very young, because as the generations go on, they're losing their Italianicity. What with the fact that there's a lot of intermarriage now. Of course, our culture is getting much more diverse in America, so the chances of intermarriage are even greater. And so it's going to dilute the Italian cultural experience to a certain degree, or its interest. I see this, most of the people in the baby boom generation see this in their own children. You know they're Italian and they have the pride, but they don't know the language, they don't know much about the history and the culture. Right. And as time goes on and as that intermarriage continues, that's going to be our greatest challenge. So what we really have to do is to continue to get, I think, and I have suggested this, people on the verge of retirement or in early retirement, people in their 50s to their mid-60s, I think is a good age group because they retired. They don't have work responsibility, and they're probably looking for something to do. They're still young enough to chair a committee, still young enough to go bopping around, still young enough to set up programs and things like that. When you start getting into those late 70s and those early 80s, and as you well know, some in their 90s, yeah, there's going to be a tailing off, and that's natural. So I would like to see more of an attempt by the membership committee of the state to really put their efforts in that regard and make a real forceful effort to try to increase the membership in that regard.
Right, because as you said, we're losing our Italianicity. Yeah. We're melting into the melting pot so much, yeah, now. Yeah. I know my grandparents came, my grandfather, 1896. So we're in America 100 years already. Many cases, that's the same thing. Now, the last time I heard of major immigration from Italians was in the 1950s after the series of earthquakes that they had there. Mm-hmm. So we have a lot of members, well, not a lot, but we have members in our group that were from Italy, mm-hmm, and came over in the 1950s, mm-hmm, the mid-50s, the late 50s.
And we have such a rich legacy that we should share. I always say, and as a former social studies teacher, I can, rest my laurels on this comment, and that is, you take the development of Western civilization, you take any event, and I could do it from ancient Rome to now, there was an Italian or a group of Italians somehow part of that major development in the development of Western civilization. I mean, from the ancient Romans all the way down to today. In fact, when my History in a Box covers from ancient Rome all the way to the modern day.
And hopefully we're going to get that on our show too.
Oh yeah, someday. It'll be wonderful. It plays the rave reviews, and I've done 40 presentations already, and I'd love to keep doing more.
That's wonderful. So what do you see as your future role in Sons of Italy?
Well, I love the CSJ, and I must say, I would hope that future presidents continue to select me as their chairman. I serve at the pleasure of every president. It's usually a two-year term. And so, thanks to our past president, Joseph Rondinelli, he saw fit to appoint me as the chairman. And I took the job on with gusto. And then Carolyn Rears, our present incumbent, she felt that I could continue, and I do. So I hope, really, anything to do with either fighting bias and bigotry or promoting positive image of Italian people, particularly dissemination of or promotion of our culture, that's where I want to be. Because I know, having been a former social studies teacher, having been in this job, you really get to appreciate your culture more than most people. And I've said that publicly. And so it makes you defend it harder. When you know there's so many wonderful people doing so many wonderful things in the order, to be sullied by a defamatory stereotype really upsets me. And that makes me drive on, fight on, continue to be the pimple on someone's derriere as much as possible so that we get corrective action of some sort. It's a beautiful culture. It's a rich legacy. I always say the Italian people are the chosen people of culture.
Gentleman,
hands down.
I agree with you on that. But, here on Long Island, there's such a high concentration of Italians.
Use a pejorative term.
I'd say it's almost rare for us to come across some of the bigotry that people in other parts of the country might element
to somebody's family.
For instance, she and her husband
every bit of phone number I could find.
The first week, they were online at a restaurant.
Email address.
Waiting.
I went to what I was called a lodge base. The base is everybody in the order. I get it on Facebook, I get it
the,
out.
The gentleman in front of them was a happy cowboy hat on with a big silver
buckle. They normally, of course, resisted, and when they did resist,
brawl.
We even had counsel take a look at it. Counsel even tried to negotiate with
them. What's the matter
we're willing
with these
to actually
guys?
Pay
he must
for
be one of those Italian, lazy Italian.
Like they come from Italy.
This exactly.
They tried also in New York State. They supposedly entered the Saratoga Raceway.
Were there any Italians?
At the Saratoga Raceway, and I believe
we
was came from
Governor
Cuomo.
They
told him, you can't come here, you're out. And supposedly contracts were signed. He spent $300,000. Liz Rizzo one time gave me a call a couple of years ago. She said, you have to come to my house. I got this important demographic I want to show you. And she showed it to me. And I understand that was the 2000 census, but we also found that in the 2010 census, the greatest number of Italians in this country by county is Suffolk County. More than Los Angeles County, more than New York County, which is Manhattan. Most of the Italians in this country by county are right here in Suffolk.
Wow.
Yep. So it's a very important role that we play in defending our legacy and also promoting our culture.
Lou, I know you've been fighting bias and bigotry for many years. Historically, what are some of the battles you've had in previous years?
Another issue we had was the Holiday Inn Express up in Latham, New York. And that was about 2 years ago. On January 1st, on their New Year's Day party, they were going to have a mafia party. One of our gentlemen, who was our district chair there at the time, actually happened to notice it on radio, happened to see it on TV, contacted me. We again inquired, and of course we were getting the runaround. The manager claimed that it wasn't his doing. He'd have to find out, you know, who did this. And when they contacted, they never contacted me, therefore. So we had to put more pressure on. We found out who the owner of the hotel was, who was an Italian-American. He was infuriated, and he fired the management company. And that mafia party, we found out about it after the fact, but there's no mafia party in the Holiday Express, Holiday Inn Express anymore because of that. Another issue we wrestled with was the Transportation Columbia Association of New York. This is a union of transit workers. 95% of them are Italian Americans. And on their payroll sheet, they have a designation for a WOP, W-O-P. And what it means is without papers. And what happened there was the particular transit system. If you are a union leader and you're working on transit time, you don't get paid by the New York City Transit, you get paid by the union. So you would bubble in your payroll sheet under WOP. But a lot of the workers there got upset seeing that, and they just wanted it eradicated. I made contact with their personnel division, and after some investigation, they totally agreed with us, and they said they were taking that off. So we were pretty victorious there, I would say. Another issue is we're fighting some of the city papers. The New York Post, the New York Daily News, they seem to be very, very loose about glorifying mafia stereotypes. We were incensed at some of the things that they've done. And we wrote personally to the editors. We sent emails. We put up a real big fuss. And lately, the New York Daily News has calmed down quite a bit about some of these things. Right now, the New York Post is doing the same. They put on page one that John Travolta is playing Gotti, and they also did a hit on New York City mob restaurants where all the historical mob hits occurred, and we basically, you know, criticized them for what does this have to do, what kind of redeeming value does this have for your readers? There's absolutely nothing to do, and lately they've calmed down, but I want to physically meet with them and discuss that this particular matter and tell them that they got to do better. And how they can do better, as you know, we have this rich legacy. You want to write something great about Italian people? They got a whole sea of heritage and cultural institutions and cultural ways that we've done for so long, they could surely do something a heck of a lot more positive than that.
Well, you know, the media is so important. We live in a very high-density Italian-American areas. As you pointed out, Suffolk County has the highest concentration of Italian-Americans perhaps in the country. But in other parts of the country, you go to Kansas, you go to Oklahoma, Texas, you go Utah. people only know about Italians what they see in the media. And so if this is saturated with mafia, it's...
And we have found out they only represent 0.0078 of 1%. So that's about 500 people out of, what, 20 million Italian-Americans? Right. Yet they get 98% of the attention because that's what sells. All right? And instead, what we do that's positive, you're lucky if you get 2% concentration. So we're trying to change that, and I have tried to push national as much as possible on this. And my nephew is a film producer in California. I've had sat down with him for lunch one time, and he told me what to do, and I think it's a great idea, and I would like to see it happen with the national CSJ, is you got to get into these film schools, NYU, USC, UCLA, Columbia. Find out what these kids are doing. Back it. Support it. Get it out there. Have them produce it. And you do, if it's a hit, then guess what? The Francis Ford Coppolas and the Martin Scorsese's are going to be making nuts kind of movies instead of the stuff that they're making. So that really needs a national effort. I really do also believe we have to sit down with the producers and the writers' guilds and say to them, because they're the ones responsible for the creation of this stuff on paper before it hits the screenplay. And I would think that our contact with them is important, because then hopefully we can influence their thinking to try to push them to do something more positive. Daryl Zanuck used to say, it's not the script, it's the story. If the story is good, it'll sell. So there's no reason to constantly resort to these defamatory mafia movies when they could produce a really sweet story. A perfect example is Brooklyn. That show, Brooklyn, it's about an Irish girl who came to this country. She met this Italian boy, and I watched all the stereotyping. There was none. This wasn't a kid that didn't have that surly talk or that wise talk. He wasn't dressed in all of these, jewelry with the hair neatly coiffed. He was an average kid, and the family was an average family. None of this stuff, the stereotype, with the halter top on, mm-hmm. and smoking a cigarette with the wine and all that, with the tattoos up and down the arm. None of that. And it was really a love story, because she felt uncomfortable at having met with this kid's family. She had a choice whether to go back to Ireland, where she was pressured by her family, or should she stay? And she decided to stay.
Oh,
I thought it was a great story, and it did play to wide acclaim. And there's no reason why all these creative producers and writers can't do the same thing. There's really no reason.
Well, Lou, I want to thank you on behalf of all Italian Americans for the wonderful work that you're doing. I know we have a very, very capable soldier here to fight this battle for us, and your work is amazing, and I feel an overwhelming gratitude for what you're doing.
I'm glad you did.
Thank you for being on the show.
I would come back in a rocket minute, no doubt about it.
All right, thanks again.
Beautiful.